Hello, ladies and gentlemen. I'm not actually here to introduce the talk. It is just past 12 on the last Friday of July, and this is the day that certainly in the community we try and remember people who've been forgotten about for the other 364 days of the year, as it is Happy Sysadmin Day. I remember when I finally managed to get away from sysadmin servers and Nagios stopped sending me text messages. And it was sort of like missing an old friend or a small child who insists on waking you up in 4 a.m. So this is the time we remember those people who install those printers and run the network cables and get woken up because a disk has exploded, or change your password because you've forgotten it yet again. Perhaps not with a smile, but possibly with some good humour. And so I do see a few sysadmins around the place, and a huge thank you to everyone who does this on a day-to-day basis and keeps our systems running. But I would like to say a special thank you to DSA and the DebConf sysadmins. Could you stand up and give us a wave? In fact, no, come here, come up on stage. We do have a little something for you to say thank you to for all the work you put in, not only at DebConf, but throughout the year to keep Debian and everyone else running. Anyone in DSA? Yes, Paravoid, up you come too. So thank you to all these people here. Thank you very much.
So to go back to the schedule, Andy Bart and Build Wanna Build.
So thank you for the introduction. Thank you, Morgan, for stealing 10 minutes from my talk. Now we start with Wanna Build. So what is Wanna Build actually? It's a central auto-building database. It's a whole system consisting of scripts, websites, and so on. It keeps tracks of the state of packages, where state here means not which suite which package is, so not the primary information. The primary information is which packages are built or needs to be built. It merges new package uploads from FTP master roughly every 15 minutes. It schedules some packages for being built. It can record BinNMU requests where we could say, okay, please just rebuild this package in a fresh and untainted unstable environment or testing environment or stable environment. Then we have a web page, build.debian.org, as usual. Then there's a Wanna Build one. Then there's build.d, that is just a daemon that runs onto each physical machine of auto builders. It connects to Wanna Build currently via SSH. And it starts, and if there's a package to be built, it starts as build, which is actually just building a package and saying, yeah, I built it successful, it failed, or something was just broken. And then build.d does the right action. And actually, they are very similar, but not exactly the same to the one we have currently in the main Debian archive. But it has been far worse than what we currently have. So why do we have auto builders at all? Well, what is their purpose? Their purpose is to build packages in all architectures that we have within a reasonable time frame. There are always a bit of small delays, but they are not an issue. So don't be surprised if a package is uploaded but not directly built within a couple of hours. 1 or 2 or 3 days of delay are not an issue. I mean, normal testing migration kicks in after 10 days. So if a package is uploaded 2 days after upload to unstable, that's not a problem anymore. And they exist to avoid that someone needs to provide packages by hand. I can remember well when people from the security team didn't have auto-builder support and were not amused at all by the many architectures they have had to provide packages for. So that's one of the great reasons why we need auto-builders in Debian for our work. And basically, we as build maintainers, we make sure that the buildies work, that they operate, that they have working change routes, but we don't have the responsibility to make sure that all packages work successfully. That's basically the task of the individual maintainers, and of course supporters need to support the maintainers, but it's not support a task of the auto-builder maintainers to make sure everything happens. And if it fails to build, there are porter change routes where you could write. So you can try to fix it, to debug it, to get help from the porters, and up. And then if it works, please don't just upload some crappy binary from there, but upload a fixed package to unstable. So what's the package lifecycle? Packages usually start at the source package plus uncompiling binary is uploaded to FTP master. Then it's accepted into the archive, often at least. Then vulnerability marks the package as it needs to be built. Then a buildie picks the package up. Then the package is hopefully built after some time. Then it's marked as built. Then it's uploaded and marked as uploaded. Then it's the binary package is usually installed in FTP master, and then it's marked as installed in vulnerabilit. And then basically the life cycle from the vulnerabilit's point of view is already done. Then there might be an next source upload and so on and so on. So there are of course sometimes problems. Sometimes the auto builder just fails to set up the change route properly. For example, apt-get install gives interesting errors or can't connect to a mirror, to give an usual example. Then the package just is given back. That means it reappears in the needs to be built packages list again. There's another issue. The auto builder could start the build, but the build fails intermediately because of an error in the package, of an internal compiler error, or so on. Then it's marked as failed in the vulnerability database. And sometimes you see a package just disappears and reappears in the list of packages that needs to be built. That usually happens if a package is given back more than once. Because, for example, it could have virtual dependencies or some dependent on package fails to install properly in the change route. That's a very nice thing to do. The full build log is usually with version information of all packages available on the build.debian.org website. So if it fails to build in a change route, one of the first things you could do is just to compare, do you have the same versions locally installed in your change route than on the build daemons? Because that could be a reason for failing on other architectures where you even don't need a porter change route to fix that or to debug them. So the build environment is these days are mostly cloned change routes, which means we have a clean change route, we clone it, do something in the clone, install packages, do whatever, and just throw it away afterwards. The word mostly is there for a reason. On some architecture or on some build daemons, that's not architecture dependent, we still use the old style of having one change route where we remove packages afterwards. Also on the KBSD ones, we don't have LVM, obviously. But we could, for example, move there one day to ZFS. We could also use on Linux BTRFS, which I'm looking forward to do at some point in time, which probably will just give out another number of funny bugs in the BTRFS file system, as we usually find interesting bugs with the build daemon setup. We have also these days usually automatic experimental backports etc change routes, because if you use a clone change of unstable, we could just add more sources lines to it, install package from experimental and throw it away. Nothing is lost at there. The change route contains the binary packages from main and conzip these days, and that's even so if packages are built for non-free. So non-free packages cannot build with non-free binaries, but only with binaries from main and conzip. And we can't change that because currently FTP master doesn't check that non-free packages are allowed as build dependencies for other non-free packages. So we have now, that's starting our new section, we have now since sometimes that build daemons automatically assign packages which are built. At least the pack is build daemons, or most of the build daemons that are administrated by Debian system administrators. There are a few build daemons where it has not been added yet. There are a few build daemons which are not run by DSA, which of course also don't do auto-sign packages. And don't do auto-signing means usually you have to wait for half of a day till a human comes around and signs the packages, which of course imposes a few delays. For auto-signing, there's a GPG queue specific per build daemon, which is very short-living and is rolled over, and we now had the first rollover, and we learned a few things that we could do different for the next time. We found a few bugs in DAC, but usually that's just the way if you do new things for the first time, I mean. Another new is we did queue reordering. In former times, needs build was just a fixed queue order, so first all required packages were built, then all important, then all standard, then all optional, then all extra packages. And therein, first all libs were built and so on. And that was, if we had a small delay in the build daemons, the optional packages were built, really still built very fast, so you uploaded an optional package and just built. But the extra ones just starved and don't build for 20 or 30 days, which was really a pain. Now we changed that. We sort the queue by points, which are dynamic and change over time. So you get bonus points for having a high priority package. For example, an important package is of course considered with way more points than an extra one. But you also get points for just waiting to be built. So if a package waits now for 3 days for being built, even extra package waiting 3 days for build has a higher priority than an optional one just being uploaded yet. You also get malus points, of course. If a package takes very long to be built, it just gets malus points. It gets malus points for being concept, for being non-free. Mark, why are you looking that way? So, and of course, the points can just be adjusted manually. So we could say, well, we know this package. It gets a bonus of 10 points. Yes, Wouter? Sorry? I would repeat it if I would have understood it.
Whether you're also assigning malus points for like uploading 3 times in half an hour or something.
Well, if I notice bad maintainer behavior, I might manually adjust the points.
But not automatically.
Pardon?
Not automatically.
Not right. Automatically, but there's a bit bad way to deal that automatically. And even, and basically, I mean, if you don't have a backlog, I don't really mind. If you have a backlog, they get the malus point because the package is just freshly uploaded, which means they don't get the bonus points that they are waiting for being built. And so, and it usually works quite well. I guess by doing this change, we increase the overall throughput of our build daemons by something like 20 to 30%, which isn't bad for just the ordering things. On some architectures, now it starts to be interesting. We have architectures where different buildies consider different queue orderings. This happens for the case, as I just said, packages which build quite long get malus, but what we want to avoid is that all four of our four build daemons are stalled by two GCC uploads, one glibc upload, and one OpenJDK upload. That's why we do on these architectures have one build daemon which just always picks the very long building packages up, and the others build the small ones up first, so that we hope that we don't compile long building ones and all build daemons at the same time. So that's why if you look at the queue isn't, what you see as queue is not exactly the same as build daemon C because there is not a unique view on the queue of the packages anymore. And the other news is new packages can just enter the queue at any point. There are packages which enter the queue at the top. There are packages which enter the queue in the middle and there are ones that enter the queue at the bottom. And also packages, yes, and packages do queue jumping. Sometimes, due to the way we measure, and I haven't had better ideas yet, it might happen that packages overtake each other in the queue a few times till they eventually be being built. That's not bad itself. I mean, the important thing is not the queue orders. The important thing is that we build all packages in a timely fashion. And it doesn't matter which package exactly is first being built from the global point of view. But so please don't be surprised if packages do queue jumping. That's just normal. And it's not a point of worry to me. That happens because of the bonus points for being waiting for being built. That handled a bit different with waiting times. And if someone wants to have the nasty details, I could tell about later. But just for general, it's not an issue. It just happens. So other news that are not visible to users is we did a lot of code cleanup and refactoring. We used to have a handwritten function for doing option parsing with 200 lines of Perl, which now have been just replaced by one get options clause. I mean, that's just good news. We removed lots of dead code. We had many implicit assumptions in the code. For example, oh, a buildy is speaking with me if there's no terminal connected, plus the name starts with buildy underscore, which of course wasn't true for my ground jobs asking things. We have a YAML API for taking packages, which allows us to pass more information from the vulnerable to the build daemons. For example, we now say on the vulnerable side, oh, if it's experimental, you need to take this code for solving build dependencies. We consider build essential always as available. There was a time when a dpackage upload has happened, so just vulnerable said, oh, dpackage dev now has used a different dpackage version. Oh, I cannot build any packages anymore, sorry. Which is of course a very great thing to just shut down all the build daemon network. We not avoid this these days in saying we have all essential packages are available as packages without dependencies, so dpackage dev can just always be installed. Which is of course just anyway since the change not available, so we don't mind. We also moved settings that we used to have in the distributed in the code in the database. We moved settings that, we did YAML files, which is still better than just having it split over all over the code. But I think other people here know how Debian codes look like. We use for our Archive triggers now signals. So if we get a trigger that a deinstall has happened, we just touch a file, and this file is later up picked from Gron, which means we avoid to stall on any other people, and we could work with that we have triggers overlapping, so that if we take longer than we need to signal to process a trigger, it's not an issue anymore. It used to be, and more things. So there are many small changes, cleanups happening, and this is actually a good thing. The code has been better, but it's still a maintenance nightmare. There are smaller bits. There is, oh, I see now a tech error. If in your home, you could have a .vulnerable YAML, which allows you to specify individual preferences. So for example, I have output format options in my file where I can just say, oh, I want to have the output of vulnerable in a format which I can directly pass into a shell to give the packages back to for being built again. There are two directories on Greek where you could look for examples. The one is an org vulnerable etc YAML, and the other one is my home. There is also a character missing thanks to tech. And the vulnerable database is these days, or quite for a long time now, available for all Debian developers, except the database for security builds, of course. So we have the website, as I said before. There has been lots of improvements, mostly by MIDI, of our new and working user interface. We have a quick view of architecture status, where we have problems, where we have backlogs. So if you go on the first page of the Build Daemons website, you can just exactly see which architecture has which queue links in which suite, which was information that wasn't available that way before, and which just helps us as well to see, oh yes, this architecture has packages which haven't been uploaded yet. There's still a small things. The presentation isn't optimal, so not everything that looks at the first view as a problem is a real problem. But at least we from the buildy side could see which one is and which one isn't, and it helps us to make things easier. It also makes it easier for people to find out what is the status of their packages, which of course is important. One of the questions that's open for me is really, in my opinion, even though the website isn't really feature complete, there's nothing where I would say off the top of my head, oh yes, we definitely need this and that to happen on that side. So if you have things you would like to see, please tell us about. Then there is packages are specific, which is just a very old inherited file, which says this package should be built on these architectures, or this package should not be built on that architecture. We started to pass architecture lines from the source packages instead of, and don't do so much using the packages are specific file, and also not for us setting in the vulnerability database we got rid of. So what we slowly do is we move from manual work, which needed manual work by the build admins, by vulnerability admins, to things that could be just automatically read from the packages and source packages lists, which I think is the right place for information to be stored. There's no need to duplicate information from that list to some other lists and to require people to just do that. So we avoid manual work. We can't get rid of package R specific at this point in time, but we don't need to invest as much time as we needed to in, earlier. So we have, of course, open issues with the build daemon network. One of them is we need more cleanup of things, of code, of things to happening, and we need even more cleanup. So that's not just joking. That's really very, very, very bad Perl code, which we inherited for quite a long time. It used to work with Berkeley DB files. It then was more or less with large hammers put on a PostgreSQL database, which was an advantage because the Perl DB, because the Berkeley DB files just were way too insane. We have now issues with we are just producing very much logging, which enjoys DSA every other day, of the way we do logs in the databases. We need to check that, which means we need to do a little bit more of Perl cleanup, or of refactoring the code again to make smaller logs in the database. We have had some unusual conditions which are not particularly handled well, but which mostly work. And of course, as always, we need way more test cases and test suites. Good news is that we have at least some test cases now, which we hadn't had before at all. But it's only covering a very, very tiny part of vulnerability, not the real operation of vulnerability, but rather just the parsing of packages files. Of course, documentation is, I'm not using the word non-existent, but yeah, well. And there are always some issues that some hardware is broken here, so a machine hasn't survived a system upgrade, or that change route is broken. That's just more or less everyday stuff which will continue to exist until future. If there are large transitions, sometimes we have issues, oh, season that change route hasn't been updated yet to use a new Perl, libc, GCC, whatever version, is not multi-arch compatible yet. Whatever, there's always a nice transition coming along in Debian. Of course, multi-arch will require some change at our side as well. Currently, we don't see large ones yet. We have a few ideas which might need to be changed, but I'm sure we will detect more when the time comes along. And we need to unify configuration even more. We want to move configuration, which is currently on each build daemon on its own, to a central location where we only need to configure it once and not on each machine as it is. I personally would like to be able to do some build post-processing before a build is signed and uploaded, which means we could detect certain issues on the build daemons instead of just on FTP master. So that was it now, what I could present here without going into too much into details. Any more questions, suggestions, anything else?
Have you considered to give malus points when a package fails to build from source?
How do we what? What was the word, the third word? How do we?
Sorry?
Can you just repeat the question? I missed the first part.
Yes, you have a points system to decide which package gets built first.
Yes.
And you have bonus points and malus points. Mm-hmm. Have you considered to have malus points for package which fails to build from source on another architecture?
I haven't considered malus point for a package which fails to build from source. We have malus point for packages which have not yet been built at all on that architecture. That's a malus because the package is uncompiled and we consider it a higher priority to first build the packages which have already been built on that architecture before building new things, which I think is the right decision. I don't think we should put malus points for packages. I mean, if a package is just constantly fails to build from source, we might be. I also was considering to...
No, not constantly. I meant in another architecture.
Ah, yeah.
For example, if a package fails to build in four architectures, maybe you just don't bother to try it in architecture which is slow or flaky.
Yes, okay, yes. Yes, that we have considered. Basically, what I have considered was if a package fails to build on too many architectures, just demote it a bit on the other ones, but that's a bit, it's not so easy code-wise, and calculating, I don't want to spend too much time in calculating priorities, but eventually I think we will get along to that point to make that happening. I just don't have the right database query in my mind to do it, but perhaps it will happen sooner or later. I mean, the idea is good, I just don't see how to implement it at the current point in time. But yes, good point.
Well, actually the question was already answered, but one point that came into mind is that we shouldn't really put much of effort into the points, but rather to have faster buildies so we don't have to care about the order. The builds will happen fast anyway.
I don't want to overstress the points, but even on fast architectures, sometimes they are important. We have had spikes where every architecture was below a 98% of instability of package current mass mark, which means just a large transitioning is happening. So yes, what really annoyed me previously was that I was only available to use big hammers. So really, since this bonus malus points is mostly done currently, or perhaps even it is fully done, but it's still important because there will always be times where not every package can just instantly be built, and it's good to have some layers of priority which has a bit more adjustments than only saying yes or no, but just say, okay, we have a bit more sane order.
Do you have any statistics on how the, say, average waiting time changed? Did it help to, which feature of the point system did actually help more to reduce the waiting time, that kind of thing?
I don't have any statistics, but I have a quite clear opinion about which things help most. That was that experimental and optional packages could overtake each other together with the fact that waiting time gives bonus. So we have, for optional packages only, we mostly have a first in, first out. The same as for experimental, and the queues overlap a bit. So that's a basic essential thing, and we got rid of very nasty things we had before. Before there was really a long list of package of just different sections within the Vanna build code, which said if you're in this section, you get this many points, and that section you get that many points. It was really just incredible. And now we got rid of most of this old code and just say, well, we just order by points, and by points, by waiting by time being spent in the state, since a bit of time, and next one would then be a name, which is enough, which is fairly more simple than what you used to have before. But yes, that order by waiting time and over optional extra packages could overtake, that is, I think, the core thing which really helped much. And it could really be seen that the queue length was just cutting down 2 weeks after that on some architectures. Now I think the next one was Joachim and then Martin.
There's a question from IRC to ask about Arch all-order building. I think it means arch all bin in mewing. Are there any plans about that?
Oh, show me code. Yes, there are plans, but there's not code available yet which could do it in an appropriate fashion. And arch all is even a bit more complicated. There are arch all packages which only can build on certain architectures. For example, if you need a cross compile, if your arch all package contains or happens to contain BIOS for Spark and MIPS and MIPSL, you should build certain architecture which have cross compilers for these flat architectures installed.
Okay, and the other part of the question was about throwaway binaries. Will that happen soon?
That's not a Vanabuild question.
Well, Vanabuild will have to build the arch all package in that case.
Well, I think I could say now what we have discussed, which already was announced or was set up about from the FTP masters, was that the first step would be to throw away the binaries which are not arch all on the upload together with source. So from a Vanabuild point of view, the only change is that we need to build more packages, especially on E386 and AMD64, where we have just two build daemons which just wait around and do nothing because they're just idling most of the time. But all the sys step would help quite a lot, and about the architecture all binaries, we could think at a later point in time.
On a related point, do you have a plan for dealing with the packages that are architectural but can only be built on certain architectures? There are a handful of these.
Yeah. From the Vanabuild build maintenance point of view, that's not a question because we don't build them. But independently, we discussed a bit to annotate in the source package or in the package on which architectures this package should be built.
Right.
So that's the current discussion we had at Mr. Black 4 days ago. But just the idea, it's not a plan yet.
Yeah, this has been discussed a couple of times recently, and there was some question as to whether we should allow it per architecture or binary package within a source package. So you could imagine a source package declaring it has one arch all package, builds on PPC, one builds on Spark, one builds on AMD64, and we think the... somebody was saying something about QMU to me at some point. Okay, we worried about that one because we thought the Vanabuild people might get upset if we asked them to deal with that. But yes, there's certainly, if anyone's got any code or proposals for that, we'd be quite happy to look at it.
But I really think if we do that, then we could easily just consider the package as a binary package of the first architecture it could be built on, and then we are just done from the Vanabuild side. But I think that won't happen within the next 2 months, but I think it eventually should be done.
In the release team talk, there was this idea of having a customized experimental repository, sort of personal package archive. Do you think it will be a huge work on Vanabuild's side, or are you ready to implement this in a few hours? I don't have any idea if it's going to be a lot of work for you. But the point is that we have to work exactly like not like experimental, maybe, but because we would like, in this case, to pick up build dependencies in the personal package archive. Okay.
Well, actually, I think some more work needs to be done on the FTP masters again. Mark, don't you just want to join me here? But from the one, so it's more the FTP masters, I would say, and.
Yeah, I mean, we're nowhere near having it ready on FTP. As for the question Raphael just asked, I think the current plan would be not to set. Not automatic in the release files for the custom experimental suites, unlike experimental, which is the point you were saying about automatically pulling in dependencies, in which case I think that should just work.
But from the Vanabuild side, it's not so difficult. I mean, we have two of these things to do. The first thing is really Vanabuild can't cope with that a package could be in the same suite multiple times. So the question really is, do we need to set up an old Vanabuild suite for each PPA, which has some, I would say, effects on web page and configuration, which we can't do today? So we need more built-in auto configuration, or should we rather just say, well, we have it as one vulnerability suite, in this case, a database schema doesn't match anymore fully. So there are a few things for the vulnerability side. For the build daemon side, it's just a question of how do you pass the appropriate up-sources lines within the build. So that's the first question. And the second question is, how do we get the appropriate apt keys, or do we just auto-install them because it's just one key which is handled by FTP master, which would be preferred by us. But so yes, there are a couple of things. So there's nothing I would say it's technically spoken totally hard or impossible, but there are things that need patches, and at least I currently don't see who has time to do the patches properly, and I definitely don't like patches just being half done and falling on our feet. We already have enough trouble with the maintenance of built-y S-build software, and it has been a trouble to us for some times. Upgrades to new major versions usually reveal new major bugs, which isn't so good for us because we don't like to just shut down the vulnerability network for 2 weeks for a software upgrade and hope that it works after that again. So nothing is really hard, and if someone has time, I'm happy to provide hints and ideas and whatsoever, but I don't see it happening from our side with the people who are currently working on it. I think Martin raised hand before, no? So, okay, yes, that's done. So any more questions on that? Anything from IRC? Okay, was it? Good. Then I would say we are done. Thank you for being here, and yeah, let's have some more discussions afterwards. Thanks.